I'm stalling a little bit. What happens is we usually have our practices at 7 in Auburn-ish, Carl, between Winder and Carl. And so when she contacted me to play at 7, I said, we'll do the best we can because it's a little further from a lot of us to drive. So I'm the last one coming in to get ready. A lot of folks come from work, and all, and so we're doing the best we can. But if I can tell you about our first three pieces at one time, I'll make it a little easier. Our first piece is called The Best of Henry Mancini. Okay, so we're basically a patriotic concert for you tonight, but we've got a few pieces just for fun that we hope you recognize. This from Henry Mancini will include The Pink Panther, The Baby Elephant Walk, The Sweetheart Tree, very, very free melody, and it will end with Peter Gunn. And then our next piece is highlights from The Wizard of Oz. Okay, so hopefully you'll recognize those. Of course, we have If I Only Had a Brain, and We're All to See the Wizard, and things like that. So it's a very classic Wizard of Oz piece. And then our third one, again, just fun pieces that we hope you recognize, is highlights from The Sound of Music. This is the 50th year anniversary, I believe, of The Sound of Music, so we included it in our program. We have, of course, The Sound of Music, My Favorite Things, Do Re Mi, Flying Every Now and Then. Those are all medleys together of different songs, and we hope you recognize them. So just give me a couple more minutes and we'll be able to start.
Thank you. Thank you. As you can see, this is the Auburn Festival, the 4th of July special festival, where they have all kinds of vendors and bands, and they will have a firework display tonight. So we'll show you some clips from this. Freedom Fest. This is an annual event every 4th of July where several thousand people come together, and it's just starting. It's about 5:30. People are just getting here, and a little later there'll probably be several thousand people here. And the firework display is usually fabulous. As you can see from this aerial view, the vendors are all set up here, ready to go, but the people are coming in. Probably in about another hour or two, the field here will be just full of families having fun. And then about 3.5 hours from now, you'll have the fireworks display, which everybody just loves every year, the fireworks. And this is just a really big annual occasion here in Monroe, the Freedom Fest. As you can see, at 9 o'clock is a little difference in the football field here. As you see, it's filled up quite a bit, quite a few people, not to mention all the cars. I'll zoom around here and you can see all the cars in the parking lots. There are quite a few people here tonight for the big fireworks for the Freedom Fest. This is Paul Mullins with Walton Entertainment.
Good morning, everyone, and my name's Joel Burnsett. I'm the Agriculture and Natural Resource Agent and the County Coordinator for the Walton County Extension Office and the University of Georgia. I'm here this morning to talk with you about a few things that popular topics that might be going on during the middle of the summer with your lawn and your garden. The first thing I'd like to talk about is we are right in the time to treat for mole crickets in your lawn. If you're not familiar with mole crickets, they're small little insects that tunnel under the ground and look like crickets. You usually see their damage in their lawn early in the spring, so late March, early April, people will see small tunnels in their yard, smaller than like moles will tunnel, so they're not huge tunnels, but they're small tunnels. And they feed on insects under the ground and cut the roots of your grass. And so where those tunnels are, people might start seeing patches of their grass dying. The bad thing about it is when you see the damage in early spring, you cannot treat for them. It's not the correct time to treat because they have laid eggs at that time. So if you treat in early spring, you will kill the adults, but then around this time is when the eggs that they have laid will be hatching. So you're basically throwing your money out of the window if you treat in early spring, because you could have killed all the adults, but about this time you'll see a bunch of small insects emerge. So now's the time to treat. You can go to any store that has a lawn and garden center and most likely find an insecticide that is labeled to apply to your lawn for mole crickets or other insects. And now's the time to apply, late June, early July. And this will kill the adults and the eggs and the baby insects that they have laid. So now's the time to get that out of the way if you saw mole cricket damage in the early spring in your lawn. The next thing I'd like to talk about is for the people who are working in their lawns that did not get their pre-emergent out to kill the weeds, now's the time to be applying. A lot of people are applying post-emergent herbicides, which is for the weeds that are out in your lawn. Now's a good time to do it, but with the heat waves we've had and the really high temperature, dry weather we've had, I would really suggest to hold off, because if you apply a post-emergent herbicide to your grass in high temperatures like this, it can make the chemical react a little differently. It can become very volatile, and that can lead to damage to your grass. So we don't want to damage your grass. So if you really have to apply a herbicide, I would really keep an eye on the weather and apply at times that are below 90 degrees. We don't want to apply it to the lawn when it's above 90. The third thing I like to talk about is it's not really a new insect, but it's been around the state for several years now. But UGA Extension is partnering with the Georgia Forestry Commission, and we're trying to educate people on awareness of the pine beetle. The pine beetle is been found across the state, and they attack pine trees. So if you have pine trees in your lawn or your yard around your house, and you're noticing that they're yellowing, a yellowish tint, or they've turned red and they look dead, then you might want to call the extension office and have us come out and look at the tree and assess the situation and see if pine beetle is in the tree. Because they can spread, even if they've infected one, they will go from one to the other and kill all the pine trees. It's really had a huge effect on the pine trees in Georgia. UGA and the Georgia Forestry Commission, we're doing a lot of research on this insect. And if you call us, if you notice any symptoms, there are sprays you can spray on the healthy trees, because once they attack a tree, it's too late. You can't stop them. You cannot get them out of the tree. They will kill that tree. But if we can get out there early enough and get a positive ID that pine beetles are there, then the other healthy pine trees in your area, we can spray them and they will not affect those trees. So that's something to research, or either call the office and I'll be happy to share more information with you on that. But that's a hot topic right now also. And like I, right now, we're in the middle of the summer. Our vegetables are needing a lot of water. So make sure you try to irrigate if you have irrigation. And if not, then hopefully it'll make it through. But it's been kind of dry. We need more rain, more thunderstorms to come through. But as I always say, scout your gardens every day. Look for any signs of diseases or insects. And if you have any questions, just give me a call. I'll be happy to talk with you over the phone and answer any questions. Or I can come out and we'll take a look at your lawn or garden together and see what we can do. But thank you and have a great weekend.
I'm Elaine Oakes, Director of Keep Walton Beautiful in the Walton County Recycling Center, joining you today with this week's edition of the Walton Waste Watcher Report. Today I just want to share a couple of things. We finished up our Great American Cleanup activities for the spring, and of course now we've entered into the summer months and we've been getting a lot of rain. And so I want to remind everybody that when you're doing outside activities, it's really important to put litter in its proper place, because when you have these floods like we've been having on some of these late afternoons, the streams of the water will pick up anything that's along the street and it will carry them into our storm drains and will stop them up, and that can be the cause of a lot of accidents. So even though you know, people might not think about that, litter has that kind of effect too, and it's bad for it to go into the storm drain because it can get into our water supply. But eventually when it stops up the storm drains, when there is a lot of it and the storms are really heavy, it can clog them up and make our streets and sidewalks flood. So that's important to remember. I also want to mention that we just have completed our annual litter index. We do this every summer and we have some of our volunteers work with us on that. We do the our litter index is where we drive along specified streets and highways and city roads. We do them by commissioner districts. So we have six different districts that we drive around, and we try to decide how much litter there is on these streets, and then we compare it from year to year. Overall, our score has been below 2, and 1 is no litter at all, and then 2 is slightly littered. So we've been really pleased with that. It did go up just a little bit this year. I think it was 1.57 last year, and it was 1.87 this year. So we did notice that there were a couple of districts that had a little bit more problem than others, and we are going to be looking at some of those areas and seeing if there's any reason for it or anything that we might can do as volunteers during our Rivers Alive in October to maybe target some of these areas. But once again, I want to just make everybody remember that it's really all of our personal responsibility. You know, we can talk about it till the cows come home, as the old expression goes, but everybody's got to do their part to try to put their waste in its proper place, and then we won't have litter at all if people will just do the right thing and not, you know, throw it outside their car, not leave things on the back of the truck that are unsecured that can blow out of the truck, you know, just not being careless in general. So I hope you will remember these things and work with us on this. If you're interested in participating with our volunteer network, please let us know. We would love to have you. We can be reached at 770-267-1421. Thank you.
Hi, this is Jody Johnson. I'm here with the Recreation Report. We want to wish you a happy 4th of July. Hope everybody has a fun activity and is staying hydrated out there, because it has been a hot beginning of the summer. With that being said, our football season will start soon. You know, it always seems like the seasons are always switched up. Football season's just around the corner. Teams are already starting to get selected here at the Recreation Department. I know high school teams are out there getting ready. So we're getting close to what they call football season, which is our fall sports, which is actually our biggest season here at the Recreation Department, where we have our fall baseball and softball, which has really grown this year by a few hundred people. We have our soccer season, and then we also have our football and cheerleading. which is what traditionally people think of in the fall season. But we have around 2,500 kids that are participating in those three different sports. Well, four sports counting the cheerleading. So it is a busy time for us. To reflect back on the spring, what we had going on, we still have a few baseball teams that are still participating in All-Stars. None of our teams won the baseball USSSA state tournament, but a couple of them did come in second place and have decided to advance to the World Series. So they've gone to Gulfport, Mississippi. I know our 14-year-old team has done that. So good luck to them. They're playing this week as we speak, just before the 4th of July. So hopefully they'll come back with a World Series championship. We really hope so. A couple of our softball teams, as you know, we hosted the Tri-County Tournament, which is around 80 softball teams from Gwinnett County, Walton County, and Barrow County. They all come in, and this was our year. It's a rotating basis. We held it around 14 years ago, and then it came our turn again to host that event. So about 80 softball teams come in, and it's a week-long all-star type tournament. We did have a couple of teams that did real well in that division, including our 12-year-old girls from West Walton. So congratulations to those teams that either won the pre-Tri-County or the Tri-County tournament. They always represent Walton County well. And our West Walton staff, I want to say Jane Vico and that whole crew did a great job hosting that tournament this year. Each year, if you're hosting, you actually become the president of the Tri-County Association. And Jane did a great job communicating to all the teams. As you know, in June and July, we have these pop-up storms. So when those things come up, you have to be able to communicate to all the teams, the coaches, and the parents to let them know what's going on, where to be, and what time. So they did a great job with that. And our, of course, our field crews always do a good job maintaining the fields. They look their best when we need them to. And like I said, our grasses are green and cut just right. And congratulations and thanks a lot for all the hard work that all our staff did to make that a successful event for all our All-Star kids. So again, we'll move towards the future with our fall sports programs. And as always, we encourage you to come out and join our community centers. As of July 1st, it starts a brand new year. I know most people think of January New Year resolutions, but July is the best time to join the community centers. They're only $104 for the entire year, and that's a family membership. You can't beat that price anywhere. It's your tax dollars at work. We were able to get grants for all the equipment that we have out there, and we try to keep it up very nice and neat for you to utilize. So, and we have two community centers for you to go to, the one at Belker Park and the one at Meridian Park. So get in and join those community centers. If you just like a tour or a free look at some of the classes that we have, our staff will work with you on getting you in there and letting you view some of those classes that we have to get you in shape and keep you nice and healthy. That's the main goal of those community centers, is to keep everyone healthy in Walton County. So get in and look at those community centers, because they are here for you and your families to utilize. If you have any questions, if you've missed registration or if you have any questions, give us a call at Walton County or go online at waltoncountyga.gov. Our phone number is there to contact any of our offices. We'd like to serve you and like to keep you informed of what's going on. So until next time, thanks a lot.
I'm Emily Russell, Director of Marketing and Business Development at Clearview Regional Medical Center. Thank you so much for joining us today. I hope that you and your family are enjoying these warm temperatures and getting outside, maybe exercising, eating some good fruits and vegetables from the garden, all of those wonderful benefits that come along with summertime. So speaking of summertime, since gardens are in full bloom, harvest has begun, the farmers market in downtown Monroe is up and running. That brings us to fresh fruits and vegetables. And for those of you that may not know, June is actually considered Fresh Fruit and Vegetable Month. So to talk a little bit more about that today, I have two helpers with me, and I'll let them introduce themselves and where they're from.
Hey, I'm Savannah. I'm from Jefferson, Georgia, and just graduated Health Promotions from the University of Georgia.
Hey, I'm Kathy from Augusta, Georgia, and I as well just graduated from the University of Georgia with a Health Promotions degree.
So as part of Health Promotions, a big part would be diet, correct?
Correct.
Okay, so when it comes to diet, we always hear, of course, that fresh is better. You know, fresh should trump all. So talk to me, you guys, a little bit about eating fresh fruits and vegetables. What does that mean?
Well, according to the USDA, it's recommended that half of your entire plate, whenever you do have your meals, half of it should be the fruits and vegetables. So you should really include color and variety, and it should not actually include potatoes, because it's actually it has a negative impact on your blood sugar. And then the other quarter of your plate should include protein with fish, poultry, beans, and nuts, and should kind of limit the bacon, cold cuts, and any preserved with meats, as well as the other quarter should be whole grains, and that includes oats, brown rice, and foods made with them, so like wheat pasta. So you should really include all of those items within your meal. It's recommended, and limit dairy and milk from 1 to 2 servings a day.
So when we're talking about fruits and vegetables taking up, did you say half the plate?
Half
the plate. And you said use color and variety. Mm-hmm. So what would be an example of color? What do you mean by that?
You should have a good variety, so like orange for like carrots, and getting certain types of carotenes and vitamins and minerals, whether it be from green beans and squash. Having a good mixture of different colors means you have a good variety of those different types of nutrients and minerals.
So if I'm looking at my garden at home, I might have green peppers, I might have spinach, those are both green, so maybe vary that with a tomato or a carrot or a squash, something like that to get some variety in the color. So what you're actually saying is the color variety dictates nutritional variety.
Right. They
wonderful.
Each different colors have different minerals within them.
Fantastic. That is very good to have. That's definitely something to consider. And actually what Kathy's talking about a little bit is my plate. And my plate is kind of a neat way to know and understand the nutritional values that you should be taking in every day. There's lots of resources online about my plate. We have resources available here at the hospital through our dietitian. If you have any questions, you can let us know on that. But that's great information. Anything else about my plate that we need to be sure to remember?
You should include natural oils when you do use them. So any like sunflower, try not to use any other ones. More natural is better.
So maybe like a Crisco or cooking in bacon fat or something like that might not be the best choice. So while you might be eating your vegetables, but you're sauteing them in bacon grease, sometimes you kind of have to come up with a little bit of balance there. It's important to get those vegetables. So speaking of those vegetables, is there a better way to prepare them? Should they be fresh? Should they be frozen? Should they be from a can? What are the thoughts on that?
Yeah, so the FDA has actually done studies that show that fresh and frozen vegetables don't have that much difference in their nutritional value. Between producing the commercial produce and then the freezing process, you lose about the same amount. So it kind of equals out in the long run. There have been other studies done that show that canned, dried, frozen, fresh, and 100% fruit juice that has low sugar values are actually about the same in nutrition.
So no matter really how you get your fruit or vegetable, it's just important to get it, I guess.
Yes, yep. And having a variety of those different kinds is important too, because they have a little bit different of the benefits.
Yeah, because I've even heard that if you get canned vegetables, that maybe you should rinse them first to kind of get the extra sodium off of it with the preservatives and whatnot. Maybe that's a healthier alternative to take on.
Yeah.
So that's important. That's important to note. So you don't necessarily have to buy fresh produce, which can be expensive at times if you don't have a garden at home. You can also opt for frozen or canned vegetables. But the important part is just to make sure that you get those vegetables.
Yeah.
So let's talk a little bit more then about our fruits and vegetables. What are some fruits and vegetables that you would recommend?
Well, right now it's the summertime, so we've got a lot of gardens and the farmers market going on, and some of the fruits and vegetables that are going to be in season right now are artichokes, eggplants. You've got your sweet corn, your summer squash, all kinds of berries, cherries, fruits, melons, peaches are all going to be good and in season for this summer.
very good. And something that Kathy mentioned earlier, which I thought was very notable, I think a lot of times, even in the South and maybe in other places, we automatically consider a potato as a vegetable. So are you telling me that that's perhaps not exactly what we should classify it as?
We shouldn't classify it as a vegetable just because that doesn't give you much the nutrition that you need.
Yeah, it's really just more of a starch, essentially.
Right, exactly. And some people consider it because it is grown, and some people, you just shouldn't.
So perhaps eating a hamburger and french fries isn't giving you your protein and your vegetable.
Right, right.
The french fries don't exactly count as a vegetable. Where they might be a side item, they're not really a vegetable. Very good. Anything else to that's noteworthy about fruits and vegetables this month?
Well, it is important to know that in Monroe, from May 16th to October 10th is Farmers Market every Saturday from 8:30 to 12:30. So you can go and support your community and locally grown vegetables and fruits there.
Yeah, that's a great way to not only get those fresh fruits and vegetables, but also to support your local farming economy. You know, if you haven't been out on a Saturday, I definitely encourage you to do so. Everything from local honey to carpenter bee traps to fruits and vegetables and wildflowers and homemade dog treats, all sorts of different things, organic baked goods, gluten-free baked goods, just a variety of things out there, with the premier product being those fresh fruits and veggies. So definitely be sure and check out the Monroe Farmers Market or any other farmers market that might be around. It's just a great way to get that color variety that we were talking about on your plate when you're consuming. So, well, thank you so much for tuning in with us today. We encourage you to eat healthy, to eat right, to eat for a lifestyle that you can actually enjoy. If you ever have any questions about dietary needs or concerns, or perhaps even a dietary consult, or dietary consults in regards to diabetes, or any sort of illness or difficulty that you may be encountering, please give us a call. We have a physician referral line that we can get you hooked up with a physician or a dietitian, anything like that. In addition to that, we always have our senior events that are going on here at the hospital. We have one coming up here in June for skin cancer awareness. So learning a little bit about how to protect your skin from the sun and from developing skin cancer. So to check out any of these events or to learn about any of our physicians, you can always visit our website at clearviewregionalmedicalcenter.com or call our toll-free physician referral line number at 1-877-933-2762. Thank you so much for tuning in, and we look forward to seeing you next time.
Hey, thanks a lot for tuning in today. As usual, we're going to show you some of the dogs and cats that are available for adoption here at the Walton County Animal Shelter. You know, temperatures are getting real high out there now, and we're getting a lot of calls. You know, you might think, well, I'm just going to run into the store for a few minutes. It can get really hot in your car really quick, and a lot of people are real quick to call. We've had several 911 calls this week out to Walmart, out to Home Depot, different places where the dogs are left in the car, and it can really cook your dog very quickly. And believe it or not, there is an ordinance out there that says we can enter a vehicle and take that dog out and charge an owner. We don't really want to do that. We just want to have you keep your pet at home, or maybe keep the air conditioner on in your car while you're out. But you know, when it's real hot, just leave them safe at home, run your errands, and then come home and play with your dog. Also, we're getting calls about dogs that are chained up outdoors. Yeah, we have problems in the winter time, but it can be a real problem in the summer too. If you don't like to stand out in the full sun, I guarantee your dog wearing that fur coat doesn't like to do it either. So make sure you have a shady spot for them, or bring them in the house, and plenty of water. We've investigated calls of dogs with heat stroke. We even had one call already this summer where there was a trapped cat that had died. Someone set a trap out in the sun, hadn't been trapped for more than an hour, and the cat passed away in that full sun. So just be smart in this hot weather. You know, they're wearing a thick fur coat and don't want to be out in that just as much as you don't want to be even wearing shorts. So just think about your pet and bring them inside and do right by them. And so now we're going to show you some of the dogs and cats that are available for adoption here at the shelter.
We have us a nice red young Pomeranian here. He is just as sweet as he can be. He's nice. These are nice, good pets right here. I have one myself, but it's blonde. But now's your chance.
This is Rocket.
He's about 4 months old. He's a dachshund beagle mix. He's not neutered. He's a little skittish, a little scared, but he needs a good home.
This is Juliet. She's a border collie mix, about 7 months old. She's already spayed and has all of her vaccines and everything. She's a really sweet girl. She's already been learning some tricks and working on housebreaking. She needs a good home.
This here is Tater. He's about 7 or 8 years old. He's a long-haired senior dachshund, black and brown. He's very sweet, unneutered male, and he's looking for a great home.
Okay, we have litter mates. The gray and white one is a male. The one she's got is a female. They're about 3 months old. They just need a good home.
This here is Miss Rose. She is a black and tan female spayed men pin shepherd mix. Very energetic, very sweet. She's looking for a good home.
We have a 3-year-old neutered male. He's a red bone mix. Very sweet. He's already neutered. He does need a good home and a good bath. He made a good pet, lots of energy.
This is Rosebud. She's about 1 year old. She's a Labrador mix. She's very energetic. She just needs a good home and someone to love her. Come on.
Do you have a collection of films and videotape sitting in your attic, basement, hall closet, or a box somewhere that are being lost to time? Creative Artists can transfer your 8mm, Super 8mm, and 16mm films, as well as converting your VHS, CVHS, 8mm, and Mini DV to DVD. Preserve your family's video history for the generations to come. Creative Artists, 1113 West Spring Street, Monroe, 770-267-7368.
Where do you come alive? A stadium, lecture hall, a music hall, church potluck? This year, you have a new spot, walkgeorgia.org, a free website that provides you with all the resources needed to get your heart rate up and body out in your community. Sign up and receive individual or group fitness tracking, fitness demos by certified trainers, recipes, and a guide to resources in your Georgia county, all in one easy-to-use site. When you move more, you live more. WalkGeorgia.org.